Dear colleagues, I would like to welcome you at my presentation. It is dedicated to fault-tolerant approach for photovoltaic module-level power electronic applications. My name is Andriy Chub and I'm representing Tallinn University of Technology. I would like to mention that this work was developed in collaboration between Tallinn University of Technology and Warsaw University of Technology. The main object of this study is DC-DC converter based on series resonant quasi-Z source topology. And we studied feasibility of fault tolerance to semiconductor faults. This is for a reason, because the recent study of DC-DC and resonant DC-DC converters published in Magazine of Power Electronics, based on the polling of industrial experts, showed that in industry around 60% of failure on resonant DC-DC converter corresponds to semiconductor components. So this issue has to be addressed more in details. Recently, there was a study published in the Magazine of Industrial Electronics by colleagues from Kiel University, Kassel University, European Center for Power Electronics, and so on. And it showed that there are five basic methods of active control and design approaches that target the reliability of power electronic system. The green bars correspond to the active control approaches that contribute to the improved reliability. And the blue bars correspond to the design approaches at that level of their importance according to the experts. So as you can see, the fault-tolerant topologies have been considered by many experts. And in our opinion, this is a very attractive solutions due to low realization cost of many of the fault-tolerant topologies, and in particular, the one that will be presented later on in this session. As you can see at this slide, our approach is based on application of a hybrid switching cell that you can see here. This is basically a full bridge switching cell with addition of a series capacitance. To have this capacitance is very important in galvanically isolated DC-DC converters, since it allows you to use the switching cell either as a full bridge or a half bridge cell without saturating the transformer. So what happens if we have a short circuit fault in the switch S4, as you can see here? Basically, this short circuited device, semiconductor device, create a current conducting path that could be used for a configuration of the switching cell into equivalent half bridge cell. And the converter can continue operation as a half bridge. In case of an open circuit fault, the same current conducting path could be created by turning on the switch through control and basically getting the same result in this case. Similar thing could be done in case this hybrid switching cell is applied at the output side. In one case, in normal operation, it operates as a full bridge rectifier, and the other case as a half bridge by turning on one of the switches employed in the rectifier stage. So basically, the case study converter is based on the quasi-Z source DC-DC converter with synchronous rectification in the output stage, in the rectifier stage. As you can see, we have eight switches, so this is basically a dual active bridge with the quasi-Z source network at the input. Quasi-Z source network allows us to achieve wide input voltage regulation, which is beneficial for photovoltaic applications to address the temperature variations as well as partial shading that is possible in the system. So general principle was presented by us at ICIT conference last year, but this study provides more specific case studies as well as experimental results. So if we have a short circuit fault of the switch S1, as I discussed before, the faulty device is basically short-circuited here. So in this case, the input side cell operates as a half bridge. But in order to maintain the DC voltage gain value, we have to change the modulation of the output side cell, which is done. So you see here that one of the switches is turned off and the other one is turned on, which basically shifts the output side switching cell to operate as a half bridge rectifier or voltage doubler rectifier. In case of a semiconductor fault at the output side, and here we present you an example of an open circuit fault. The concurrent conducting path is created by the switch SA through the turning it on by control system. As well, a similar modification are made at the input side. So you see that one switch is turned off and the other two are controlled by the microcontroller to stay turned on. This creates equivalent single switch quasi that source converter, which is in some way similar to Hall bridge converters in case of voltage source converters. The converter operation in the normal mode is actually the same as a typical quasi that source converter. So in order to regulate the voltage, the control system creates a shoot through by symmetrically overlapping the control signals of the MOSFETs, input side MOSFETs, while the output side MOSFETs perform synchronous rectification during active state in the input side hybrid switching cell. By this means, the input side hybrid switching cell generates symmetrical voltage pulses applied to the transformer, and since this voltage is symmetrical, the capacitor C1 and C2 operate under zero average voltage. However, one of them or both of them could be used as a part of a series resonant tank, also employed in this converter to improve switching losses. On the other hand, in the post-fault operation mode, the switch S1 creates a parasitic current conduction path that is needed to reconfigure the input side cell into the Hall bridge. As you can see, for that purpose, S2 is turned off continuously in order to avoid any short circuit unnecessary short circuits in the system, while the switch S3 is the switch that is controlled by the pulse width modulations. As you can see from the time diagrams, this switch generates short pulses that result in voltage V1 equal to zero, which is equivalent to shoot-through conditions in the normal operating modes when the quasi-that source network accumulate power in the inductors, and the duration of the control signal of the switch S3 will define the converter DC voltage gain. Of course, there are drawbacks of post-fault operation. The input current ripple is reduced because in normal operation it's 2 times higher than the switching frequency, and here it's actually equal to it. Moreover, the capacitors SC1 and C2 will operate under certain voltage stress that depends on the duty cycle of the switch F3. Let's proceed to the next. Here you can see the parameters of the experimental prototype. The input voltage range was tailored for maximum power point tracking of a typical 60 cell silicon PV module, and the output voltage of 350 volts is useful for residential DC microgrids. The switching frequency of 100 kHz was selected during design, and the transformer with turns ratio of 1 to 8 was used to achieve all these parameters. It is worth mentioning that the capacitor C2 is very small and used as a resonant capacitor in the given case. So here you can see some steady state waveforms recorded before and after a fault in the switch S1, and this was a short circuit fault. So as was expected, the operation in the normal operating mode requires duty cycle of 0.15, which is relatively small for the input voltage of 30 volts, which corresponds to a typical normal operating cell temperature voltage of a 60 cell PV module. As you can see, the voltages are symmetrical, the converter operates as expected, as well the voltages of capacitor C1 and C2 are zero. On the other hand, after a fault, the duty cycle has to be increased to 0.23. Why it has to be done? Because the losses in the post-fault mode are higher, specifically conduction losses, because fewer semiconductor components have to handle the same power level. Moreover, the input voltage is the same, but the voltage of the transformers are asymmetrical as a result of a single switch nature of the post-fault operating mode. Moreover, the voltages and voltage stress of the capacitors C1 and C2 are not zero anymore, and they increase and depends on this duty cycle. Coming to the control characteristics, it is important to mention that in the normal operating mode, the difference of the control variable, which is a shoot-through duty cycle, is very small between different power levels, because the losses are relatively small. While in the post-fault operating mode, it's not true, and you can see the larger difference. Not only the duty cycle is higher, but the difference is also higher in post-fault operating mode. And this all results from the additional conduction losses generated in system in fewer components of the system. The same could be seen from the DC voltage gain characteristic curves. You can actually see the difference here, as evident from the third subfigure here, that the difference could reach up to 0.1 duty cycle value in relation to the same DC voltage gain. Regarding the efficiency, a similar behavior could be expected. So as you can see, that efficiency is actually rising with power in the normal operating mode, which could be predicted for a typical full bridge converters to a certain extent. However, in the post-fault operating mode, the single switch converter suffers from higher conduction losses at higher powers. And you can see that efficiency is actually decreasing. And this is similar to all the previous studies performed by us and other research groups that shows the same behavior. What could be done with this? That since the efficiency drop could be as high as 6% between normal and post-fault operating mode, the modulation sequence of the input side hybrid switching cell could be changed. Instead of using only one switch for creating equivalent shoot-through conditions, there could be another switch also used, a diagonal to the switch used. So in this case, it will be S2, S3 switches when they are controlled simultaneously. This will allow not only to reduce the conduction losses, but also to redistribute the switching losses a little bit between different switches and improve the thermal operating conditions of the components. And as you can see from the third subfigure here, that in comparison to the post-fault operating mode with typical modulation sequence when only one switch used, and the improved modulation sequence, the improvements at the maximum input power and the minimum input voltage here and here could be as high as 1.5% improvement. And here just examples of maximum power point tracking routine performed with a solar array simulator of K-Site that was emulating a 60 cell silicon PV module. So you can see that normal operating mode as well as post-fault operating mode show very similar results in terms of the maximum power point tracking performance. The main difference that could be recognized from these two figures is, of course, in the voltage of the transformer. In one case, it is symmetrical, and in the other case, it is asymmetrical. Moreover, the asymmetry depends on the value of input voltage and current, which was expected from the theoretical analysis performed. To summarize this work, I would like to underline that this approach is novel for module level power electronic systems, and the use of hybrid switching cells could be recommended since four switches can provide a lot of different modulations, allowing for tolerating different faults. In this way, module level power electronic system can provide an extended warranty with low extra cost, since, as I told, there are only few capacitors added in the system. And the proposed approach was applied to the case study quasi as a source microconverter. And the results show that the normal operating modes and the post-fault operating modes differs a lot. And if you peak efficiency can drop from 97% in the normal mode to the 92.5% in the post-fault mode. However, this is a price to pay for a post-fault operating conditions, because since a converter can continue operation even though at higher stresses, this allows you to keep the scheduled maintenance or to reduce the cost of maintenance of a residential PV system. Moreover, this enables also additional benefits in terms of warranty, because as PV modules can survive up to 25 years, here we can also expect a long life of the converters. And the future research will be based on the lifetime evaluation, how much it could be extended with the application of the proposed content. Thank you for your attention and for attending this event online, and special thanks to the funding agencies.